We have a couple of you right now. Give me a thumbs up if you had a good spring break. All right, yay! Very good. So we're gonna wait just a little bit longer for some other folks to show up, and then we will get started. Everybody, my name is Ms. Graham. I am the education coordinator here at the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. How many of you have been out here before? Have you ever been to, okay. So out here we have lots of different plants that are native to Texas. And today what we're going to talk about are the monarch butterflies, how they move from all the way from Mexico up to the northern parts of the United States, and milkweed and Texas. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen and we're going to go over a little presentation. And once I share my screen, you all will not be able, or I will not be able to see any questions you might have in the chat. So Roxanne, if you can be sure to call out or something to let me know if there's any questions. So we're going to try this. We're going to share the screen. Get to this. Go to this. All right. Is everybody seeing a map of the United States? Thumbs up if you see a map of the United States. All right. Perfect. All right. So like I was saying just a minute ago, we're going to be talking about monarchs, migration, milkweed, and Texas. And as we look at this little map, I've got these pictures kind of going in a certain way. We're going up. We're going in a pathway. So that's important to remember. Think about that. And we're starting way down here low, outside of the United States. Let's find out a little bit more about it. All right. So first thing we need to know, though, is we need to know a little bit more about the monarch butterfly. And this is the life cycle of a monarch butterfly. Now, first thing, we've got our grown-up monarch butterfly. And this monarch butterfly is flying around and it's starting to look for some place to lay its eggs. But a monarch butterfly is very, very particular. It will only lay its eggs on a milkweed plant. Now, I wonder, how does this butterfly know which plant is a milkweed plant? Because we've got millions of plants out there. So what butterflies do is they taste the plant. Thumbs up if you know how a monarch butterfly tastes its plants. Oh, Mallory, do you know? Can Mallory tell us?
It lands on the flower and gets the nectar.
That is how it gets something to eat. You are so right. Let me tell you about the way it tastes the plant to see if it's a milkweed plant. So butterflies have taste receptors in their feet. So what a butterfly does, it's flying around. Can y'all fly with me? We're going to fly around. We're flying around. Oh, there's a plant over there. We're going to land on the plant and we're going to taste it with our feet. Mmm. Is that the right one? Oh, no, that's not a milkweed. And it has to fly to another plant. and it's going to another one, and it's going to taste this one over here. No, that's not it either. And then it flies on to another one. Oh, let me taste this one. That's it. Okay, it finally found a milkweed plant. Now it can lay its eggs. So it lays its eggs on a milkweed plant, and then it flies off. Its eggs are right there. Let's look at these eggs. Look at this. They're so tiny. Here's what one looks like a little bit bigger. And it takes about 10 to 14 days for these eggs to hatch. Now, normally on all the life cycle pictures you see, normally they show a full-grown caterpillar, and that's what this is. But that's not how they start off. Look at how tiny this little caterpillar is in this picture. They start off really super duper teeny tiny. And the very first thing that little caterpillar is going to eat is its shell from its egg. So it's going to eat this eggshell. Okay, so it's got its first bit of food. Okay, it's better. It's ready. So now it's going to get on to the leaves of a milkweed plant, and it's going to start munching and munching and munching and munching. And so when a plant eats, just like when boys and girls eat, you start to grow, and you grow and you grow and you grow. And what a monarch butterfly caterpillar does is it has different growth cycles. It will go through a molt. It will actually shed its skin 5 times. And each one of those times it sheds its skin, it's molting, and it's called an instar. There's 5 instars. And it grows almost 2,000 times its normal size. So eventually it gets about this big. And then it has finally grown as much as it can grow. And it realizes, it's like, oh, I feel the change coming on. I've got to change. I'm going to metamorphosize. So what it does is it spits out a little silk mat on whatever it decides to start metamorphosizing on. It might be the bottom side of a leaf. It might be a twig. I have actually seen a monarch caterpillar do its thing on the underside of a hard hat. So they'll do that anywhere. And then it forms what's called a chrysalis. And it's important to know that butterflies form a chrysalis. It's not a cocoon. A moth is what forms a cocoon. So this monarch caterpillar has formed its chrysalis. And in about another 10 to 14 days, it will change and metamorphosize into a butterfly, and it emerges. But look at how wrinkled its wings are. What it has to do is it has to pump fluid into its wings. So let's start pumping fluid, everybody. We're gonna pump fluid into our wings. Okay, everybody, let's pump fluid. Come on, let me see you pump fluid. Here we go. Okay, now stop. Your wings are out because they have to dry, because its wings are wet right now. So it's gonna be just sitting on a flower or a leaf with its wings out, drying. And it might stay this way for a couple of hours. And then finally, after the leaves dry, or its wings dry, it's able to start flying around looking for something to eat. And it will be looking for different types of flowers. So that is the process of what a monarch butterfly goes through. That's a whole generation. And that's important to know, that that's a generation of what it does. Now let's see what else happens with this monarch butterfly. Because like I talked about, they migrate. So monarch butterflies, they're kind of like me. They don't particularly care for the really cold weather. And they go head down to Mexico in the winter, and they hang out there where it's warmer. And they rest, and then They have a pathway. They start flying and they go through Texas and they go up to the eastern part of the United States, way up high, and in the southern part of Canada. And we're going to go into a little bit more detail about exactly what they do. All right, so starting about March, they're going to get into Texas. So they've come from Mexico, they're flying into Texas, and they're looking for some place to lay their eggs. And it's on the milkweed. And how are they going to find that milkweed? They're going to use their feet and they're going to start looking. They're going to be looking for that milkweed plant. They're going to lay their eggs on the milkweed plant. And then that is going to be the very first generation of new monarch butterflies. And that first generation is going to start flying north. They're going to go up towards the top of the United States. So a bunch of them are going to go that way. And then as they're going north, they're looking for more milkweed and they are laying more eggs. And another generation of monarch butterflies continues the journey on north. All right. Then, they've been really busy. They've been flying all summer long, all spring, all summer. And by the time they've gotten up to the northern part of the United States, they're up to their fourth generation of monarch butterflies. And that's the generation that has to come all the way back down to Mexico. And that generation will not lay any eggs. But what they have to do is they have to make the journey back. So they're really going to be looking for some food, and that's their nectar source. So they need flowers, and it can be other types of flowers. It doesn't have to be just the milkweed flowers, but they need flowers. And they're also going to have shelter along the way because it's summer. And depending on where you are on that pathway back, you might come across a really bad rainstorm. So you'll need to have shelter. Now, the monarchs, they're really tired out, and they finally reach the center part of Mexico in about early November. And there's mountains in Mexico, and on the southwestern side of these mountains, there's a forest full of the fir tree. It's sort of like what a lot of people think of when they say a Christmas tree. It's kind of got that shape, and it's called the oyamel fir trees. And that's where these monarch butterflies go. And they go there in the thousands and thousands of monarch butterflies. So if you look at this little picture right here, if you can everyone see that arrow moving around? Thumbs up if you can see the arrow moving around. Okay. So just imagine that little picture. And if you were to just put that picture on top of each other till you had a whole tree's worth, and then you had hundreds and hundreds of trees that look just like that. That's how that forest looks. Monarch butterflies everywhere. So that's where they hang out all winter long. And then the process starts all over again. So now let's see what's next. So we talked about the monarch butterfly and how they migrated. And now we're going to talk a little bit about why it is so important about that milkweed. Just what is it about the milkweed? So we talked a little bit earlier about how that monarch caterpillar will eat only milkweed. And the adult monarch butterfly will only lay her eggs on milkweed plants. Now, something really interesting about the milkweed plant and the monarch butterfly and caterpillar. The milkweed plant is toxic. It has this white sap is toxic to other animals. And because over the years and years and years, this butterfly and this caterpillar have started to eat it, their bodies have adapted to it. And it doesn't bother them as much. When the little caterpillars are really tiny though, it can bother them. And something that Ms. Graham just learned, that what some of the caterpillars will do is that they're going to go to this little section of the leaf. Can everyone see this little section that I'm pointing to? And they'll start chewing it. And they will kind of chew around it just enough to make the sap stop flowing into that leaf. So here they've got a chewed leaf. It's not quite fallen off of the plant, but it's separated enough that this milky sap is not going in. Oh, I did not want to do that. It's not going in to this part of the plant, of the leaf. So the caterpillars can munch out on this, and they're not getting as much sap into their system. So it's a little easier feed for them. So it's easier to eat. And the monarchs will eat on, okay, get this, 27 different kinds of milkweed that we have in North America. There's 27 different species. So no matter where you live in North America, there is probably a type of milkweed that you could be planting that will be native to your area. And this one is called the Pineland milkweed. So probably for folks in areas that have lots of pine trees, the piney woods, that would be a good one for you. This is a swamp milkweed. So if you live in swampy areas, the bogland, lots of areas that have a wetter environment, that would be good for you. And this one is one that we have in our area called antelope horns. And so you can find this one in Central Texas. All right, let's see what is next. All right, so we want to help these monarchs as they go through Central Texas. And migrate means they're moving from one place to another. So some things that people can do is you want to make sure to plant the native milkweed plants that are in your area, and then also plant other types of native plants that are nectar plants. So plants that will have flowers that the butterflies will like. And so when I say monarch larva, that's another word for the caterpillar. And we always want to remember that those caterpillars grow up on the native milkweeds in the springtime. And then the grown-up monarch butterflies, they're going to need both the milkweed plant and they're going to need the nectar plants in the springtime, both of them. And in the fall, they need the nectar plants so they can get lots of food and have the energy to get all the way from the way top of the United States all the way back down to Canada, I mean to Mexico. And we should try to remember to plant drought-tolerant species of plants, because right now, even though we have had rain and we've had snow recently, our Central Texas area is coming close to a drought season. So we want to make sure to try to plant plants that are drought-tolerant or drought-resistant. And then one thing that's important is that there's a type of milkweed that is not really wonderful for the butterflies and the caterpillars. And it's this one right here. This is called tropical milkweed. And it has to do with it. It survives a lot longer than the native. It stays in bloom and it actually messes up the cycle for these butterflies. And there is also a disease that I believe can be attributed. I'm not positive about that one. There was a whole lot of information about that. And if this is of interest to you all and to your grownups, look it up. But this one right here is tropical milkweed. You do not want to plant the tropical milkweed. You want to plant this one, which is called butterfly weed. And so there is a difference between those two. But this is the one you want to plant. And can you all see the difference in the flowers? Like this one is just different colors of orange, But this one actually has yellow and orange. So there is a difference. All right, let's see what's next. Okay, now the milkweed seed itself, it can be kind of tricky if you want to try to sprout one up quickly. Milkweeds don't like to be rushed. They like to take their time. And I know for me, I like to sometimes put something in a little pot and I want to see it growing up. That's not going to happen. But I wanted to show you all and talk about that process. All right. So if you've got milkweed seeds, the way to get them to sprout, if you're going to put them in a pot and do it that way. Okay, are y'all ready? Sit down, get comfortable. This is a process. First, you have to soak the seeds, and the seeds look like this. This is a milkweed seed, and this is what it looks like when it's still in the plant. So you have to soak the seeds overnight in water. Okay, so you do that. Then you have to take those seeds and put them into a Ziploc baggie. And that Ziploc baggie has to have something called perlite in it. And that's something that gardeners use a lot of. So you have to do that. Then, after you have done that, then you have to put them in the refrigerator. And I would say definitely mark it so nobody tries to eat it. They might think it looks like cottage cheese. You never know. You have to put it in the fridge for 30 days. That's a 3 and a 0. 30 days. And that's got a special term. Gardeners and people that work with plants all the time, they call that, okay, are you ready for it? Cold, moist, stratified. Y'all try to say that. Cold, moist, stratified. That's a very big, important term. It's putting something in cold and letting it sit for a while. Now, after your 30 days is over, you can take that out of the fridge. And then you're going to put it into a little pot that's got some other type of potting up. It's not actually soil, but it's a mix that you put the seeds on top of. And then you have to ever so carefully cover that up and gently water it in. And then you have to check it, kind of like taking its temperature. You have to make sure it stays kind of wet, not soppy wet, but just moist. And then, after you've been so very patient, those little seeds are going to start to pop up eventually and germinate. That means you'll see the little seedlings come up and the little leaves. And you have to wait until the real leaves come up. So most people think that when you see the seed pop up and you see those two little first leaves come up, that those are the true leaves. No, those are called cotyledons. And those are not the first true leaves. Those are the seed leaves. You have to wait till the next set of leaves come up. So after you've seen that, then you put them into some little 4-inch pots. And then you let them sit for a little bit longer. And then eventually you can get them into the ground. So like I said, it is quite the process to get a milkweed seed to germinate, you know, and put into a little pot. But there is an easier way that we can do this. And we're going to take a look now. So let me go to the next slide. What we're going to do and what I'm going to show you how to do in just a few minutes is we're going to make seed balls. Or I'm going to show you how to make seed balls. And seed balls are a combination of some different natural materials. We're going to use soil, and I like to use garden soil or topsoil, but it needs to have just a little bit of clay content in it. And I don't mean the kind of clay that you would buy at the store. It's natural. It's what's already in your soil. And the way you kind of can tell that is if you grab some garden soil up out of your yard, you gently put just a little bit of water on it and roll it out. If it rolls out and kind of makes like a ribbon or looks like a snake, then your soil has clay content in it. and that's good to go. Then you're going to use a little bit of sand, and that helps makes the seed balls stronger. And then you want to use some compost, and that will have nutrients in it, and it will help absorb the water. So you get those three ingredients, and you'll have that, and you're going to mix some seeds with it, and you're going to mix it all together, and then you'll add a little bit of water. And I've got some visuals for you. Let's look at that. So this is what it looks like. Now, what we're going to do is I'm actually going to make some seed balls up so you can see what the process is. So when you have an opportunity to make some seed balls, you're going to know exactly what to do. But I need to do a little bit of changing up of my screen. So bear with me while I get things changed. All right. So I am now going to go here, and I'm going to go here. All right, here we go. So we've got, so we should now have, here's Big Me. Okay, so we have that one, and you can see that well?
Yes.
Perfect, all right. So what we're going to do to make seed balls, first thing is you're going to need a tray or a plate or a paper plate or something to put your materials on. So I have this tray. And then you're going to take one scoop of compost. So what I have is a measuring tablespoon. And one scoop is normally about a tablespoon. So I'm going to take my one scoop and I'm going to put it right here in the middle of my tray. Then I'm going to take one scoop of sand and put it on top of the compost. Now, I'm going to take three scoops of soil. One, two, three. And sometimes, like you can, if you can see this, sometimes your soil is going to have rocks in it. So you just have to take the rocks out. It's not a big deal. So we take them out, add our soil in. I make a little bit more in since I did take out some. Okay, there we go. Now, I'm going to mix this all together. Can everybody see how I'm mixing it all together? So you're going to mix it all together. And then you're going to take some seeds. And I'm going to use a quarter teaspoon of seeds. So what I have right here though is, oh, I only have an eighth teaspoon. Okay, but if I use two of these, that's gonna equal a quarter teaspoon. So I'm gonna put one, two of these in here. And now I'm gonna mix it all up again. So I've got this mixture of everything that I need, but can I make the seed balls just like this? What am I missing? The water. I need water. All right. This is the tricky part. Now, if you have ever made cookies and you know how that feels, it's the flour and all the ingredients are squished together and it will hold together. That's what we're wanting to do with this. So we're going to add just enough water. So you start off kind of slow. You don't want to add too much. But sometimes if you do add too much, that's okay. And you start mixing it up. And there's no really set amount, perfect amount of water that I can tell you to add, because the soil, whenever you get soil, your soil might have a little bit of water moisture in it already. So you wouldn't need as much water as someone who's using soil that's really, really dry. So I need just a little bit more. Oh, and you know what? I don't think you can see it right here, but right here, this is, oh, it's hard to tell. Can't tell right there. That, oh, you still can't hardly tell. You know what? I'm going to get you a clean one to see. There was a milkweed seed right there to show you. They're tricky little things. Can you see that little milkweed seed? That little light brown thing? That is a milkweed seed. So we mix up everything. Okay, so this is about right. Now, see how it's all sticking together? And what you're going to do, and this actually is almost too wet. So if you find that you've gotten too much water in your seed ball mixture, it's not a problem. You just take a little bit more soil, you put it in, and you mix it up. And then what you're going to do is you are going to take this soil mixture and you are going to form little blobs or balls. I like to put it on, I have a piece of aluminum foil. This is what we use when we have students come out to the Wildflower Center. We put our little seeds on our seed balls on a piece of aluminum foil. And so we just make our balls or blobs. Like I said, it doesn't have to be a perfect ball. And these are about the size of a shooter marble. Have y'all ever played with marbles? If you've played with marbles, that's about the size they are. So there we are. Our little blobs. And this should make between about 6 to 10 of these little blobs or balls. And some people really like to make an absolutely perfectly round ball, and that's fine too. That's what's so nice about this. If what you like to do is make a perfectly round ball, then you can do that. If that's not a concern for you, you can make a blob. It just needs to be kind of roundish and stay together. And the reason I am making smaller ones is we want to be able to spread these out in a wider area.
Julie?
Yes.
We have a question.
Oh, okay.
Are there plants available anywhere or only seeds?
You can find milkweed plants. It's not that easy though, because of the fact that they are rather difficult to germinate and get started. They're not always easy to find, but they can be found. If you look, I have found them at plant stores that have native plants. And if you happen to find them at a big box plant, big box type store, you should definitely check to see what type of milkweed it is, because like I was saying, there's so many different types. If you were to find a milkweed plant that was like the swamp milkweed, a swamp milkweed is not going to do really great planted out in our really rocky soil that doesn't get hardly any water. It won't be real happy. So you definitely want to check to see what type of milkweed it is. So that's for the big box stores, that's always real important to do when you're looking for plants. and see where they're coming from. Because a plant that might do really well in Minnesota, if a plant has been shipped from Minnesota, it's probably not going to do as well here in Texas just because of the heat difference. So, but yes, they can be found, but you have to hunt. And yes. All right.
So we have another question, Julie.
Yes.
What are the types of milkweed that are native to Central Texas? What are the names of the milkweed?
The one that I know of the best, the one that I really know that's native to Central Texas, is the antelope horns. And it's that, my hands are all dirty. We'd have to get back into the PowerPoint. I would have to show you. So that's what they look like. Can everybody see all the St. balls? How many did I get? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I got 9. I got close to 10. Okay, so let me get us back into, well, here, let me get me back into the PowerPoint and I can show you what the antelope horn looks like. All right, so we're going to go to new share. All right, did it come back up for y'all?
Yes, the PowerPoint is back on.
Okay, let me find it. Okay, this one where I'm have the arrow, that is what's called antelope horns. And that is, that one right there is the one that is, I know for sure, native to Central Texas. And that's the only one I know for sure. I would need, if you get on our website and go to the section that talks about the plants, looking for native plants, it will list a lot of the different milkweeds that we have, and it will tell you what region that they're specialized for and what area they will do their best in. So, and I am sorry, I do not know all of the native milkweeds that we've got for our area. I think the swamp milkweed, like I said, probably in East Texas, that one is good. I don't know. There's so many of them. All right. And there was, let me get back to this. Zizotes. I just thought of another one. It's called Asclepias zizotes. That one I do not have a picture of. But I've actually got that one growing at home and it's starting to sprout back. I was surprised that it did, but it did come back. So let me get to the point where this is what y'all need to do with your seed balls once they're made. So once you've gotten them made, you're gonna need to let them dry and not bothered for at least 24 hours. You're gonna want them to be as hard as rocks. So really, really hard. Then, kids, check with your grown-up. And you're gonna need to select a sunny spot in your yard that doesn't have any grass or any other plants in it, but someplace where it's gonna be okay to grow some flowers and plants. And you're just gonna throw those little balls out there. And that's all you're gonna do. You're not going to plant them. You're not going to do anything else. You're just going to let nature take over because the seeds are close or within that seed ball and they're being protected right now. And then when the time is right, that's when they will begin to germinate for when their time is right. So when it's time for that milkweed seed to germinate, when it's had the right conditions, when it's had enough cold weather from nature, when it's had enough moisture from rain, when it's had enough heat from the sun, when it's ready, that's when it will germinate. And the same thing for all the other little seeds that are in there. When it's their time, that's when they'll germinate. And so that's what's so neat about the seed balls, is that you make them, you throw them out, and then nature does the rest. You don't have to worry about it. And so that is it. And if you all would like for me to get you the names of these Central Texas milkweeds, get me your email and I will find out and I will get those names to you. I can do that for sure. I just don't have them off the top of my head. So we can do that. And that is all I have. Do we have any other questions?
We had a question that popped up in the chat box.
Okay.
What if you don't have a yard? Can these seed balls grow in a pot or any other type
Some place where you can put soil and set them on top of. Yes, that's a very good question. Just put them in there and see what happens. That is what I tell. When this is one of our activities that we do with the school groups that come out, and we definitely, there's lots of kiddos that are living in apartments and don't have a backyard or a front yard, you know, to plant things in. And that's what I tell them. It's like, just find a pot. Or even if you don't even have that, just as long as you had some soil, and if you just had something really small, you could even just cut off like the top of a soda bottle, put some holes in the bottom so there would be some drainage, and you could even experiment that way. I mean, there's all sorts of different types of containers that can hold soil. That would be a very cool experiment. You could try different types of containers that it's okay to use with your grownups and see which container works best for doing that. So yes, definitely you can use a pot or a different type of container.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
Does anyone else have any questions? I'm gonna go ahead and end the recording now.
Okay.